whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Romans 10:13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Romans 10:13.
Great song right there. 485 in your songbooks. 485. This world is not my home, and I'm in it, but I'm glad I'm not going to stay here. I'm glad I'm passing through. This world is not. Let's stand together. 485. Brother Ham, let's sing three verses of this good song. First, second, and fourth verses. 485. Brother Ham.
485. This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what would I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Turn around with a smile now and shake your neighbor's hand.
Verse number two, 485, verse two, Brother Ham.
On the that second verse, they're all expecting me, they're all expecting me, and that's one thing I know, my Savior pardoned me, and now I onward go. I know He'll take me through, though I am weak and poor, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, You know I have no friend like You. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what would I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world. That's good singing on that last verse. Just up in glory land we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand, they're shouting victory. Their songs of sweetest praise drift back from heaven's shore. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, You know I have no friend like You. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what would I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
Amen. Good seeing you tonight. And who's got a testimony? Something good's happened this week. Who's got a good testimony? Somebody's got that. Yes, sir. Amen. Calling, good for you. Got his apartment. There's a long story to that. And was without a home for a while, I'm thinking. And, yeah, it's a long time without a home, and that is wonderful. Yes, Miss Heather?
Actually, twice this week. I have been
Amen. Yeah, that's good. That's good. Now, be careful about asking for money because God will give you a job. But that's all right. That's okay. And somebody else who's got something good happened, something good. It's been a good week. Yes, ma'am, Mrs. Zanotta. Amen. Amen. At 67 there last night. 67 people there. And that's wonderful. That is good. That is tremendous. What we're wanting to do with the Hour of Power is transition them to Friday night, because Friday night is more of aggressive. You got to work it. You got to get in the Bible. You got to do some things. At your own speed, by the way. But we transition some to Friday night. Our discussion meeting is important, especially faith-based. It's very important. Appreciate Brother Doug Jackson. I missed my testimonies. He's leading that meeting on Tuesday night a couple times already, and that's tremendous. You know, here's a man that came to the early meetings when we met in that room with about 10 of us, and you remember that, Brother Doug. And we've seen it grown, so yeah, good. Somebody else, that's good. That's great. Yes. That is awesome. That is awesome. That is awesome. That is great right there. Hey, what about Oscar Shibway? He had a kid from the Congo where he's from, came to see him play at Missouri, and they lost, and he didn't get to see him. Well, he came to another game. I think it may have been the Georgia game, and he got to see him. And they had the interview in the hallway down under Up Arena, and Oscar came out and shook the boy's hand, and he asked me if he could speak a certain language there, and the boy just froze up. He's from the same area. They got talking. You know, this is I don't know if it was Channel 27. They were doing it. And then Oscar Shibway asked that boy, he said, "Do you believe in God?" And he said, "Yes, that's good. You stay with that." And how old are you, blah, blah, blah. And he said, but do you pray? And the guy said, "Yeah, I pray." He says, "Do you read your Bible every day?" Misses this interview, and he's asking him, does he believe in God? Do you pray? Do you read your Bible every day? He's given the Christian life. I loved it. And what a blessing. I'm wearing blue because we've won a few games. Amen. Amen. I got a little more hope again. Amen. Brother Mark.
Yeah,
Good. Good. That's good. Yeah. Look, you may can't get around, but he listen, he's going to talk to you, and he does it. And they see him coming now. They go the other way. We've talked to him. Hey, Brother Doug. Amen. That is great right there. That's right. Now, the question to ask somebody is did you have one, Brother Burgess? Lay it on me. Amen. Amen. Yeah, you need to get that to him. Yeah, it is. Amen. That's good. That's good. Thank you, Brother Brandon. That is good. Well, God is good. I appreciate it. I thank God. I think we're catching a little bit of the fervor about getting the gospel out. You ask somebody if they're saved, and they say yes. Don't stop there. So, well, how did you do that? Now, they say, I got baptized. That's not going to cut. Now, you've got to be very gracious. If you ask somebody if they're a Christian, it's a good question. Are you a Christian? They say, yeah, I'm a Christian. How did you become a Christian? You can win a soul to Christ. You could take our gospel tracts, these gospel tracts, and on the back, you can just go through that with them. These things, right? Just go through, boom, 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 right down there. You don't have to be a theologian. We've got a world full of people that are Christians, but they somehow, whether it be theologians or preachers, have made them think you can't win a soul to Christ. Yes, you can. You can. You tell them how he saved you, and he can save them. Amen. Well, that's a blessing. That's a blessing. All right. Patch Kids, you can be dismissed. I like the testimonies. I like the song by the kids. I like the news, good news about last night. And I can't be in two places at one time. I was watching the girls play volleyball and the boys. I was coaching against our boys' team. They did win their first game. So I'm 0-1, and Brother Tyler's 1-0. But it ain't going to stay that way. And we get to what was that? You shouldn't have said that, Tyler. You shouldn't have said that. Some of my players are here. So y'all did hear that, didn't you? And we hurt one of your players. He's already hurt. And Wesley Ray. So it is a good time. Appreciate everyone coming out. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, I thank you for the reports. I thank you that you can use all of us. You don't use anybody more than anybody else. You just use the people that avail themselves. And I thank you for those who have a mind for people's souls. Lord, we can't get past that. We can't lose that. Everywhere we go, and opportunities to just to ask a simple question. Do you go to church? Are you saved? Are you 100% sure you're going to heaven when you die? Just in a loving way. That's not going to offend too many people, Lord. And if it does, it may be something that'll stay with them down the road that they'll never forget. So bless, I pray, what we do tonight. May it encourage us to live in thy likeness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. 219. We're going to sing Brother McKnight's favorite song. 219. 219. First, second, and fourth verses of 219.
219 little as much in the harvest field now ripened. There's a work for all to do. Hark, the voice of God is calling to the harvest, calling you. Little as much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name. On the second, does the place you're called to labor seem so small and little known? It is great if God is in it and he'll not forget his own. Little as much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name. On the last, when the conflict here is ended and our race on earth is run. He will say, if we are faithful, oh, welcome home, my child, well done. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name.
Amen. All right, we still have the Brother Greenlee. You'll have salsa this coming. All right, so Miss Walker, get one hot, one regular, and we'll mix them. That should be good. And see if you can't get it before these other greedy people buy them up. Man alive, I didn't get in on that last batch, and they only I get it on. We got it on Sunday morning, last time, or Wednesday maybe, but it's gone usually within a day. And if you are 5th grade to 12th grade, and this is a little bit late, I guess, for the basketball, Brother Tyler. Is it too late, sir? All right, if you know somebody who comes to our church, 5th grade, 12th grade boys, interested in playing basketball, see Tyler Broughton. He'll give you a handout about it. And I think we've got another scrimmage game in 2 weeks from yesterday. You ought to come out to that, see the girls play volleyball, and see the boys play basketball now. And it's really a lot of fun. Tate's Creek Christian Church, it starts at 5. And the next one is in 2 weeks. And that's where I was. I couldn't make the Hour of Power last night. But I will make it this coming Tuesday. But anyway, you know, if any young man wants to play, bring them out and see Brother Tyler Broughton about that. We have 3 boxes of candy bars left, and they're $120, $180. If you want to buy all 180, or if you want to take all 3 and sell them, please do so. We'd appreciate it very much. See me about that if you can do that, or if you maybe just take 1 box of those. Let's get them all sold that's here on the property. The last day to sign up for our Valentine banquet is tonight, so see Miss Tammy about that. This is the last time to sign up for the Valentine banquet is tonight. There will be, very important, nursery meeting Sunday, January 29th, after the p.m. service. If you are interested in joining our nursery program, come on and join them there on Sunday night, this Sunday night, right after the p.m. service. And then, of course, this Saturday at 4:30, the Secret Sister Reveal. And if you'd like to join that, you can come. You may not be a part of that, but you can come to that. You'll have a nice time of fellowship and sit here at the church at 4:30. Here's a fun activity. This Friday, teenagers 12 years of age and up, ice skating, 5:45 to 9:30. Cost $16, includes your skating and the meal following on the way home for that. Here's another great opportunity now. The teen mission trip, we only take 13. And so it's ages 12 and up, the first 13 that sign up. It's going to be less than this cost. It's April. The date's April 10th through the 14th. You'll be coming back on the 14th on a Friday. I think that's right. But you'll be going to the Rock of Ages to help, and then you'll be coming back through. Brother Thomas Myers has secured a building. In fact, I'll be going to Tennessee tomorrow, be discussing with him the beginning of that church, and we're right here now at crunch time. He's going to be able to use the monies that he's raised as a church plant to get some information out in the area of La Follette. And then the teenagers that week, you'll be able to canvass for him, because the church will be starting really close to right about the middle of April. And so and he was going to call the church Gospel Light Baptist Church of La Follette. But something with that fell through. I won't go into all that, but just kind of fell through. And so he called me last week, and he said, he said, you know, I'm thinking, preacher. He said, I was reading, and I think we're going to call it Mount Olivet Baptist of La Follette down there in Tennessee. He said, the mob needs to come here. And I said, yes, they do. Amen. So I that just come out of nowhere. And so we're excited about this. And I know my daughter said she'll be excited when they get that thing going. So we're excited. So anyway, you'll get to be at the Rock of Ages. You'll also, look, it's not just all the work and a mission trip, is it? I mean, it's a fun trip. You'll enjoy it, and you'll get to help with this church plan as well, and so that's going to be a fun time. Teen Sunday School Banquet is March the 10th, 5:30 to 8. Please look at your bulletin to keep up with these events. Cost is $10. It's formal church attire for your dress and code, and the theme is murder mystery, and I'm still scratching my head on that one. Murder mystery, and you going to kill somebody? Somebody's going to die. And but anyway, murder mystery, it should be a great time. And that is going to be on March the 10th. That is a Friday. Brother Ham also needs your help for our Valentine banquet, our adult Valentine banquet on February the 4th. And so if you're a teenager, a young person, someone that can help with that, see Brother Ham about that. Sign up in the vestibule for that. Also, this is from Brother Meason for our school. Every year at school, we have a youth challenge. It's kind of like a youth conference. It's a great all-day event. This year, it's February 17th. The day will start at 9. It will end at 2:45. Games, two preaching services, and a lunch meal. Cost is $10. It includes the lunch and also a T-shirt, and there will be a sign-up sheet on the table in the vestibule. See Brother Meese with any questions about that. So I'm excited about that. That's a fun time, and that's for homeschoolers. That's for any of our kids to go here. You want to get out of your school where you go and come for that day, you can come for that day. You need to sign up, let us know that you're coming. All right, before we recognize our visitors, let's do our memory verse. We're in Psalms chapter 1. Let me quote the first two verses. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, but sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. All right, who can quote Psalms 1:3? And his leaf also shall not wither. There you go. That's good. All right, let's see. If you don't have it now, get your Bibles out. Turn to Psalms 1:3. Let's quote it together. Let's quote all of it. Let's go from Psalms 1:1, 1:2, and 1:3. You know where Psalms is in your Bible, don't you? It's right there in the middle. Here we go. Ready? Verse 1. Blessed is a man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. And his leaf shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Those verses are so powerful, and it sounds like to me that God is promising a prosperous life if you do your part, if you get in the Word of God, and if you meditate on the Bible. There's something about thinking on the Bible changes everything. If I could get everybody in this room, when you have a dart of doubt, fear, negativity, whatever it is hits you, you run immediately to the Bible, it would change your life. A temptation. I'm reading a book now that pornography is a horrible scourge in our society. It's unbelievable. And there's a doctor, a preacher, a Christian, wrote a book on the science of it, and I'm reading that book right now. And he talked about in his much counseling with people that just are plagued by the horrible thinking that comes with that horrible addiction. He's found it works so well when they learn to run to the Word of God. And that goes for any temptation, by the way. Any temptation, right away. Run to the Word of God. And there's no excuse not to. If you have a phone, you can put it on your app on your phone. And you can run to the Word of God right away. Run to it right now. And just read it. You'd be shocked what it'd do for you. What a great chapter, Psalms chapter 1. All right, if you're visiting with us tonight for the first time, didn't see any first-time visitors out there, but you may be here to slip by us, would you please stand? Any first-time visitors? Tonight, I didn't see anybody. All right, thank you, fellas. Get your songbooks before the offering. 191. 191 in your songbooks. We'll sing the first and fourth verses of 191. Everybody get a songbook. Brother Ham.
Count your blessings on page 191. When upon life's billows you are tempest-tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. On the last, so amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend. Help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done.
Amen. Don't forget the Vivian Arnold and their family losing her brother. And I'm hoping, I don't know, I didn't get any details. Of course, she's down in Florida. And it's good seeing Miss Reynolds with us tonight. And
she's back. The service hasn't been set yet.
Okay, they haven't set the service yet, but she is back. So be in prayer for them. And it's good seeing Miss Reynolds in the service tonight and heading out of this tough season for her. And so glad you're here tonight. Let us pray. Father, I thank you that you hear us. And sometimes, Lord, you, for me anyway, I want you to work faster, and I know I'm wrong, and I know I'm impatient, and I know that. I know that. And so I ask you to forgive me when I'm impatient with thee. But Lord, I do believe in you, and I know you're the answer. I know you have the answer, and I know you have the power. I pray you would bless these we've mentioned and others later we'll pray for. We do ask you to bless this offering. I thank you, Lord, that we've heard the testimonies. And testimonies of people that have been blessed by this church that you've used to help them. And so, Lord, I'm greedy. I just want to see you continue to change lives and save souls and transform a person's total destiny through the gospel of Jesus Christ. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Excellent. Take your Bibles, turn to Malachi. Malachi chapter number 1. Malachi chapter number 1. I'm going to read just the first. We'll read 5 verses. I'll read them. You follow along there where you are. The burden of the word of the Lord to Israel by Malachi. I've loved you, saith the Lord, yet ye say, wherein hast thou loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, and saith the Lord, yet I loved Jacob. And I hated Esau, and laid his mountains and his heritage waste for the dragons of the wilderness. Now, you've got to understand in this terminology, and I don't think I'm doing a disservice to the scripture. He says he hated Esau. Esau was the most skilled of the two brothers. He had more character. In a lot of ways, he was more honorable, but he was also rebellious. And he also was obstinate, a little bit maybe a hothead, I guess, as well. But he walked away from some of the laws of God, and he's symbolic in the Bible of a man of works and Jacob of a man of grace. Because Jacob did not deserve how God blessed him. Now, he paid a price. Jacob, tricked his brother, deceived his brother, was a manipulator. Was a, the word Jacob means heel grabber. He was a deceiver, and yet God used Jacob to become Israel. It's a picture of grace. Esau was more on his own works, and God hates that. God hates any change of the gospel plan to man's work versus Jesus' works. And so understand that, and so look at verse number 4. Whereas Edom saith, now Edom is Esau. And by the way, God took care of Esau. In fact, he gave them a place where they were situated in a very secure place, in a mountainous region, in a place where there was, it was like a rock. It was a huge area. And it was, really, if you wanted to take them down, you couldn't hardly do it because of where they were situated in those days. And so they rested in that. They thought, we are situated in these mountains, this rock. Nobody can take us down. Nobody can get us. Nobody can defeat us. That's the height of pride. So you understand that Jacob, though, was more vulnerable, and he totally had to depend on God's goodness. And so keep that in mind. Whereas Edom saith, we are impoverished, but we will return and build the desolate places. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, they shall build, but I will throw down. And they shall call them the border of wickedness, and the people against whom the Lord hath indignation forever. And your eyes shall see, and you shall say, the Lord will be magnified from the border of Israel. A son honoreth his father, and a servant his master. If then I be a father, where is mine honor? And if I be a master, where is my fear? Saith the Lord of hosts unto you, O priests, that despise my name, and ye say, wherein have we despised thy name? Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the Bible, and I thank you for the thought tonight as we look at not only Malachi, but as we look at Nehemiah, the one who generation and whose season of building and reviving was the spearhead of Malachi's book and what he tells us. So meet with us tonight, please, with power. In Jesus' name, amen. Brother Stone.
Good evening, everyone. Just suppose God searched through heaven, couldn't find one willing to be the supreme sacrifice that was needed, that could buy eternal life for you and me. Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, had it not been for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost. I'm so glad he was willing to drink his bitter cup. Although he prayed, Father, let it pass from me, I'm so glad he didn't call heaven's angels. From my hands pull these nails that torment me. Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, had it not been for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost. Had it not been for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Stone. I appreciate that. I like a man sings with his heart and also can add a good voice to it. I sing with the heart, but I can't add a voice to it. What we're going to do tonight, take your Bibles, turn to Nehemiah. I felt like last week I thought the time frame of Malachi was after Nehemiah and Ezra had built the wall and brought a revival. And the nation starts to slide back. You're prone to do that. You're prone, everybody is prone to backslide. Almost made to backslide. You'll make a decision, you'll get some growth. I'm telling you, there's an enemy called the devil, and there's an enemy called this world. There's an enemy called, in some cases, your past. There's a whole lot of things that will try to get you to pull you back. And a great analogy is a baseball hitter that all of them go through slumps. Every one of them go through a slump. The best hitters, now their slump may not be a great one, but they'll go through a little bit of a slump. They may hit two or three, four games that they're not hitting to that average. And they'll practice more. They have coaches that watch them. They have videos they'll watch themselves. Now, I wish we cared more about our Christian life than a ball player cares about hitting a baseball. I really do. I wish we would realize that that's part of what church is for. It's kind of like a hitting coach, kind of like a video, kind of like to get you to look at yourself and kind of to warn you about sliding. The farther you slide, a lot harder it is to get back up. Amen. You know people that have slid maybe and they've got back and you think, well, they got away, they did it. Well, they'll tell you the heartache that comes with that. They'll tell you what happened. I've had people tell me, I don't know what would have happened had I stayed in the will of God, but I can tell you what happened, me getting out of the will of God. And it's not good. Nehemiah and Ezra ushered in a great return to God, a return to what they should do, return to so many things. We're going to talk about it. Malachi comes along and almost mirrors what they tried to do. He almost says the same thing and a little bit different, but it's basically the same principles that Malachi gives them. This is what you lost. And I'm going to tell you something about revival, returning. I've talked to a lot of married couples and putting a spark back in their marriage. It's really not any progressive, modernistic thing. It's the same old that you either quit doing or did not do, and it's just the same. And I like new technology and so forth, but it's going to be the same principles that got you to that great place. You lost that. You're probably going to go back to where you found them and redo those and return to that, revive that. In fact, the Bible pretty much is about people, they got saved and then they got right with God and they got a reviving and then they let it slip and they slid and then now we're going to return and we're going to get a revival and then they somehow, they love the joy of it and they love the mountaintop and then they slide and pretty much that's life. It's the ebb and flow of life. If you could raise your lows, don't worry about your highs. Highs will take care of themselves. Thank God for the highs. I'm not looking for a real great big high. I'm just looking for living on top side, living right, doing right. But the lows are going to come. The valley's going to come. I remind you, one of the greatest truths you'll ever hear is Psalms 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley. Not to the valley to stay. Through the valley. If you're in the valley right now, if you follow the shepherd, he's not going to keep you in that valley. You're going to come out of that valley. You're going through it. You're not going to it to stay. Boy, I tell myself, and sometimes you just need to have a talk with yourself too, by the way. Especially you that's been in this thing for a long time. You've seen enough miracles. You can go back and talk to yourself and say, look, Lord, this is a tough time. This is kind of new, but I've been through hard times before. And you're the same God now as you was before. And we're going to get through this thing. Sometimes you just need to have a good talk to yourself. Now, Nehemiah, he was a guy that saw the big picture. And he did some things and had some things that I think we also see in Malachi that you have to have if you're going to have a return to right, return to success, return to prosperity, return to peace. I mean, how many of us can remember times in our life that everything was great? Everything's wonderful. Some of you, it's right now. But you remember, things were great. Things were wonderful. Things were clicking along. But what happened? What happened? It just happens, doesn't it? Now, if you're going to return, there's some things here that'll help you. If we're going to get a country to return to God, and we need to return to God in the worst way. It is a shame that we celebrate drag queens in libraries and you can't celebrate Jesus at Christmas in our school system. Something's wrong, America. It's a tragic thing. You don't get mad at this. And then people say we're hiding behind our faith. No, I'm standing in our faith. I'm standing in my faith. I'm not behind my faith, I'm in my faith. I'm not hiding behind my faith, I'm living out my faith. And people don't want you to live their faith if it crosses how they're living. And last time I checked, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The things that were wrong yesterday is going to be wrong today and will be wrong tomorrow. That's not going to change. And wouldn't you like to see a revival? Wouldn't you like to think God used you to revive somebody else? I want to show you kind of what has to happen for revival. What has to happen for returning? Notice Nehemiah chapter number 1, verse number 1. Now understand, Malachi was probably alive during the days of Nehemiah and Ezra. Several years after the great reviving, the building, the nation began to slip again. And it got down, and Malachi, through God, or God through Malachi, showed the people what was happening. Showed them what they did. It's simple. Look, y'all, it is simple. If you put in your life the things that will remind you of who you are in Christ, remind you of what he expects of you, remind you of certain duties to keep you spiritually healthy, the chances of you slipping and staying away from God very long are they're cut down. You're in church tonight because you should be in church tonight. I'm glad you're in church tonight. It's a good place. No, this is not maybe as exciting as the nightclub, but I guarantee the results of tonight are a lot more exciting than the results of the nightclub. Amen. Nehemiah 1 says, the word of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah. Well, those names, can you imagine having that as a last name? Can you imagine Brother Ham being Brother Hakaliah? Brother Brandon writing about him on a paper, he just said Brother H. He wouldn't have went through all that. My last name was almost Piscavage. My dad's biological father's last name was Walker, but he was a dud. My dad's dad walked away from him when he was an infant. My dad met him when he was 21. He said, I felt nothing. He said, it's the weirdest feeling to see your biological father and feel nothing. He said, at 6 years of age, my stepdad married my mama. His name was Poskovich. He said, we just about adopted me, and I was going to be Poskovich. Wesley Poskovich. That's what it could have been, son. Pastor Poskovich. That just don't sound right to me. Finley Poskovich, Jocelyn Poskovich, Sandy Poskovich, Brother Poskovich. You couldn't spell it. Well, and that has nothing to do with the lesson. I just see stuff that's funny, and I wanted to tell you that. Let Brother Poskovich read on. The words of Nehemiah, the son of Akliah, and it came to pass in the month of Cheslu, in the 20th year, I was in Shushan the palace. Stop. Hold the phone. He's in a palace. It was bigger than probably this building. He's in a palace. I don't know that it was the size of the Biltmore, but I guarantee it wasn't a shack. It was a palace. Now, he's a Jew. He was a educated, intelligent, skilled Jew. He was taken in the captivity. He'd been there a while. He rose through the ranks, and now he's living pretty much in the palace. He's got a good deal going. It's not all that bad. Notice what it says, verse 2, that Hananiah, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. So they had to escape from Jerusalem, and they got there to the palace, and they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. They're in pain, they're suffering, and they're humiliated. That word reproach, humiliated. Humiliated. Notice what it says, the wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Now they state the problem. Now in Malachi's time, it was going back to that time. It was not good. And they were headed to another collapse. They were headed to another judgment of God. And I will say this, if God's ever spanked you and spanked you hard, why would you forget that the next time you think about doing the same thing he spanked you for? You may want to remember. You may want to just to remind yourself, that wasn't too good. And here, he tells them what happened, and notice what happened. The first thing that has to happen, in my opinion, to have a revival and a return. A return to where, or to where we should be. The Bible says in verse 4, and it came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Somebody cared. Amen. Nehemiah cared. Nehemiah was concerned. Are you? You understand what shape our nation is in? You understand how many people are trying to, I'm going to throw a fit about this, and I may spend the rest of my time on this. I was so mad when this was brought to my attention. You know what they're calling the king of Kentucky? Bourbon. The king of Kentucky, bourbon. There's a bottle of bourbon even now that it costs a lot of money, a couple $1,000s to get one. It's a trademark a bottle of bourbon, and it says king of Kentucky, bourbon. And just today, the man that got drunk and on January 9th, 2021, was driving on Athens Boonesboro Road at 7 p.m. and a 16-year-old girl and an 18-year-old, her brother, were going to a birthday party, and this drunk came over to their line of traffic and hit them head-on and killed them both. King of Kentucky, don't you say that to that family. And I got a phone call that a brother at 18 and a sister at 16 died. They don't have a preacher. Could you do the service? And I did the service for those kids. You don't understand. You walk up, you stand, and you got two caskets behind you of a 16 and an 18-year-old. You got mom crying her eyes out. And you've got a family, and you've got people, and they're looking at me like, tell us something. A king of Kentucky, bourbon, why don't somebody talk about that? I'll just be honest with you, I may be the only preacher in town, but it burns me up. And I say it again, I wish to God he would destroy every distillery and burn down every single a warehouse full of that rot that's destroying lives, that's breaking homes, that's ruining people. Amen. King of Kentucky. No, the king of Kentucky ought to be Jesus, who ought the king of Kentucky. He doesn't shatter lives. He doesn't destroy people. But somebody's got to care. Care enough to cry. Care enough to have a compassion. Somebody's got to care. There never will be a return of somebody. I think Malachi cared. I don't think Malachi came when he did with anger and venom in his voice. I think he came with compassion in his voice. And I know Nehemiah, he cared. The Bible says, and some have compassion making a difference. You know, we're supposed to make a difference with our lives. But we're going to have to care. It's called compassion. It's called concern. It's called unselfish. Let me tell you this. It's not enough that you succeed. It's enough that you help somebody else succeed. I'm so ashamed of myself in this area as a teenager. And I've been convicted about this here recent. And I not a pity party. But I had a chance to help a lot of young men, I think. But I was concerned about me being the best player. And me being the strongest. And I don't know that I helped any other young man to be stronger and better. And I wasted those 10 years. I wonder how many little boys in church as a 16, 17, 18-year-old I could have taught Sunday school. Because people knew me. They knew I played sports. They knew me. And I knew they knew me. And little boys would look at me, and I didn't reach out at all. It wasn't enough that I succeeded. It's enough to help somebody else succeed.
When God saved me at 19, from 19 to now, I've been trying to make up for failing as a teenager. I don't want to just succeed. I want to help you succeed. It's not enough that you get strong. Thank God you've gotten strong. It's enough that you help somebody else get strong. It's not enough that you get some knowledge and learn some things about living life successfully. It's enough as you get it to somebody else. That's when it's enough. It's not enough that you get your life back together after wrecking it possibly. It's enough as you get your life back together, you go help somebody else get their life back together. It's not enough that you got out of the gutter. It's enough that you get somebody else out of the gutter. It's not enough that you come to God. It's enough now that you give back, and many of you do. And Nehemiah had a compassion. It's not enough that God has built you a great life. It's not enough He's built you a great life. I'm sick up to here. Old-fashioned, fundamental Baptist people have taken principles from parents, from Bible, old-fashioned Bible people, old-fashioned Bible believers have taken the Bible principles, applied them to their marriage, applied them to their finances, applied them to their child rearing, and they've built their little kingdom of just right there, their little family, and they don't help any other families. They don't reach out to anybody else. They don't get on a bus route to help some kid that didn't have what they had. You got taught. You got trained. You were given some things that those little kids have never been given. And if churches like this do not go out there and get them to get them what you have, they won't get it. We can sit on the sidelines and, boy, this young generation, this dope generation, this drunken generation, that's not going to cut it. Nehemiah cared. We ought to care. We ought to have a compassion. We never have a revival without a compassion. I love what we're doing now with our volleyball, with our girls, and our basketball, with our boys. I see this parlaying into something wonderful. I appreciate you men playing with those guys last night. Brother Reynolds, I appreciate you. Brother Nick, I appreciate you guys. Even though Brother Reynolds needed a lot of Bengay and other kind of ointments on his poor aging body. That sorry devil. He comes home today after dealing with just regular stuff. His wife's dealing with kids all day. He comes home, takes a shower, and goes to bed because he's sore and hurting. But I appreciate you men playing with those guys. I appreciate those of you who come out, and Tiffany, you've come every week, and others of you, I'm missing somebody maybe, that you come out and you're playing volleyball with the girls. We're not trying to make great volleyball players. We're not trying to make great basketball players. We're trying to make great women and men of God. Amen. And we can use that recreation to do that. We can use that recreation to get them in a context where you're not wondering who their coach is. You go to the world, you don't know what you're getting. I'm just telling you. You're gonna have some man coaching your little boy in Little League Baseball, and you're going to find out later it was actually a woman that transitioned into a man. You think that won't confuse your child? Preacher, you shouldn't say that. No, I should say it. I'm just upset other preachers are not saying it. I'm not mad at anybody, but we're mentally ill in America. We are mentally ill in America, friend. There's a boy and a girl, and that's it. I mean, we've lost our minds. You know why we lost our minds? Nobody cares. We've got our little income. We've got our vacation. We've got everything set. It's not enough that you do that. It's enough that you help somebody else build a great life. And Nehemiah cared. He's in the palace, for crying out loud. Why in the world would he want to stink and go back to that place in Jerusalem that had nothing and nothing but oppression? I tell you, when God gets a hold of your heart and you care, you will go through, and I'm not cussing now, but you will go through whatever it takes, even if it's hell, to get that job done. Why? Because you care. I've met a lot of people in my life, and you have too, and there's some that have a different motor. Something in them clicked. There ain't nothing stopping them. Once they get, they've got it. That's what we need to get. It'll start with caring. What God's done with Brother Greenlee. It's amazing, Brother Greenlee. I'm afraid to say anything about it because I'm afraid God will shut up. But going over to this Jacob's house and his Privet house, we got a streamline of some guys that really want God that are coming to Sunday school. That's amazing. Good night, Brother Greenlee. He's nearing 80 years of age. It's about time to retire. (laughs) But I hope, as long as I'm my pastor here, he's still alive. Don't you die before I die, buddy. It just does my heart well. Comes out of Dunamis Club. Basket full of stuff. And still wound up. Hey, preacher! And he's telling me about something new. Preacher, I can't keep up with him. We got a guy I've been coming to his church named Mark Cunningham. You've seen the guy with the long white beard? He's the one doing all these printouts, and he's excited about getting the Bible out. And he said, Brother Walker, we need to raise $1,189,000. He said we have 1,189 chapters in the Bible. So let's get $1,189,000 to buy the property and build a community center, and we want to call it the Dwayne Walker Magnify the Bible Community Center. I'm not crazy about calling it the Dwayne Walker Magnify the Bible Community Center. And we said, we ought to put your name. I said, I don't want my name on it. Just call it, let's magnify the King James Bible. He is getting material over at the Privet House in the library of books he's gotten bought from the bookstore, and he's taking them over there, and people are checking them out. He's printing out these, you see these Genesis 1, he wants to get them all over, and we're going to get them in 203, we need some soundboards, but we'll change them out maybe four times a year, just put chapter 1 in there, and put a first class, it'll be in there. It's not enough that I get my life together, it's enough that I help somebody else get their life together. And Nehemiah cared, okay, he's set for life, he's respected, he's in the palace, but he cared. And there's something about when you care that's going to start a revival. But now, wait a minute. Hold the phone, and we're almost out of time. Somebody also prayed and fasted. Look in Nehemiah 1, verse 8. Understand, Malachi is talking about the ones who had a revival under Nehemiah and Ezra, and they lost it. They were losing it. They were sliding. And somebody's going to have to do in Malachi's day the same thing that was done in Nehemiah's day and the same thing needs to do in my day to have a revival and a return. If you have anything personally that you need to see changed or returned or a reviving personally, it'll start by you caring about the right things, and you're probably going to have to pray, and I hate to tell you, but you may have to let go of a meal a time or two. The Bible says, remember, I beseech thee the word that thou commandest thy servant, verse number 8, Moses, saying, if you transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. You see, what God did with Israel when he scattered them and he put them in captivity, he said he'd do it with Moses. God doesn't lie. But if you return unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though there were of you cast out into the uttermost part of the heaven, yet will I gather them from thence and will bring them unto the place that I have chosen to set my name there. He was praying, but he was also fasting. He was also going without food. Somebody's going to have to pray, and somebody just may have to fast. Verse 4 says, and it came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Now the simple honest truth is, you're probably not too serious about God working if you're not willing to at least let go one meal. Now some of you got a diabetic situation, you cannot. But you can do something that you let go of some physical appetite to let God know, I'm serious about what I'm asking you to do. If I'd ask you the last time you fasted for 24 hours, would it be, how long has it been? I said, but preacher, that is so hard. It's not as hard as you think if you care. How many of you have somebody in your life that you're really, really concerned and they're really, really in trouble and you're just burdened. You're overwhelmed sometimes with a burden. Does anybody have anybody like that in your life? Would you raise your hand, please? That's all over here. That's many of us. Well, guess what you ought to do? You ought to wait once a week. Don't tell anybody you're doing it. Husband, don't even tell your wife. You don't need to tell anybody that you're fasting and praying. You don't need to tell the world, bear with me, but I'm fasting and praying. And I just drove by Arby's, McDonald's, and Hardee's. and I'm dying. And I'm coming up on Sonic, so pray for me. You ought to, every time you get hungry, you pray. Every time you think of food, pray. I'm telling you, God will honor that. It's what they did in the Bible. It's what we should do if we're going to have revival. Good night. I prayed and fasted over this Kentucky basketball team. Look what it's done. I come close to doing it. I'm telling you, Kentucky basketball is a culture here. It's just part of our. It's just part of what we do, who we are, and so I told somebody, I said, look, this is our team, this is our coach. It's not going to get any better. This is 4 games ago. It's not going to get any better. I'm not going to complain about it anymore. I'm just not even going to worry about it. It is what it is. I'm not going to change anything. Me getting mad, not going to do it. Those kids are kids, whatever. 4 games later, now I'm excited again. They better not lose Saturday. I'm simply saying we get upset over a ball game and we'll worry and fret and talk about it and say, well, you got to do something. We'll get up in arms. We'll protest at Rupp Arena, go to Texas Cal. We'll do all of that. And I got people that their lives are a wreck and a mess and they're very dangling on to life. You ought to at least be able to fast and pray. Talking about revival. We're talking about returning. We're talking about reviving what has been died and what is lost in America. We could be the catalyst. You could be. This was just one man that cared. He had concern and compassion. And one man that said, I'll pray and I'll fast. And boy, what God did. If you go over to Malachi, we'll get into it next week. We're finished for tonight. But if you go over to Malachi, you'll see that what they did, he talked about in Malachi, the same stuff that Nehemiah brought out to them that they were doing. It's a way to have revival. I want us to stand for closing prayer, but before you bow your heads and before we give the invitation, Brother Green, let's stand together. I'm not going to pray, but let's stand up. Brother Greenlee went to a church on a Wednesday night, and they did something there, and I liked it. He said at the end of the service, they had a little prayer meeting like we're getting ready to have. It's going to be very brief, just like we usually do. But he said, the man got up, and he said, okay, what shall I pray for? So every Wednesday night, I think I'm going to do that. We'll have a prayer bulletin every 2 weeks, but we'll put these on the prayer bulletin. But who wants to, from where you are, just give me some things. What shall I pray for? We'll take about 4. So who wants to start? Some special prayer request. Yes, Miss Tiffany. Okay, what's her name?
Sarah.
Reader cancer, okay. Somebody else? But Mark? Mark Lyons, miracle. Somebody else? Mrs. Reynolds. What shall we pray? What shall I pray for? We got one more. Thank you. Our bus routes are dying. We got to have bodies, and we got to get serious because we're losing people. So thank you for reminding me of that. I had them on radar. We got good people. We just need help getting out after kids to go reach them. It's not enough that you got reached. It's enough that we reach them. Let's fill them. We got these great buses. We got to fill them up this spring. Thank you. I'm going to pray, and then you can come and gather around the altar, and then I'm going to pray specifically for these 4 that you've given tonight. Let us pray. Father, I thank you that we can be here tonight. I thank you for the great spirit tonight. I thank you for our brothers and sisters in Christ here. Lord, none of us here are perfect. That's why we're here. We need to grow. But I got an idea that everyone to a person here wants to be revived and red hot for thee, wants to stay right, wants to stay safe. And Lord, I really believe they want others to. And I pray, Father, we'll not be comfortable with our success.